I, along with Professor Puranik, welcome all of you to the question answer session. Yeah, so we'll start the question answer session with Mukhavkam Jha, Hyderabad.
Sir, regarding fluid mechanics and heat transfer, whatever equations are derived, as they're all available in many textbooks, but when it comes to the CFD part, that is the grid generation and all those things which have been covering for the past 2 days, could you kindly name a couple of books which could be referred to, because as you have told, during the period that you are teaching, of course that absorption rate could be low, or even if it is high, there is likelihood that we may not retain for longer time. So for subsequent reference, could you kindly name a couple of references so that we can go through and subsequently we can interact with you.
Thank you for your question. I'm happy to see your interest in taking whatever we are teaching into the practical application, that you are ready to teach this course in future. So thank you for your interest. So the question is that the material which is being covered, especially computational fluid dynamics part, the reference book, I can give you a good reference book like Computational Fluid and Heat Transfer by Patankar and Computational Fluid Dynamics by Parikh and Furziger. However, I would like to point out the details which I am giving in this course, or the finite volume procedure which I had shown, is slightly different from what is given in those books. So what I would suggest is that after you had gone through this course, you can refer this lecture notes, you can refer those books, and moreover, we have given a detailed lecture slide, and even all this lecture, right now it's a video recording is being done, and it will be put on the web. So and we will be available for Moodle interaction at least for the next few months. So I hope with all this you should be in a better position to understand. I would like to point out that right now situation is such that we are just delivering the materials, and we are not giving you time to assimilate. And CFD is such that you need to, it is not only that you can listen and understand everything, you need to work it out slide by slide, each and everything. You will have definitely have questions, you can ask us it to us, and we will be more than happy to help you out. So it will take time to assimilate the material, but I think we are giving you sufficient material in slides format, code format, lab problems, and this video recording of this lecture will be available to you. You can go through the reference material. We will give a detailed list of the reference book after the end of this course, both for the fluid mechanics part as well as CFD part. So thank you. RK College, Rajkot.
Sir, you have shown in a finite difference solution slide number 19. Convergence of iteration, it depends upon one parameter, relaxation parameter. If the value of relaxation parameter is less than 1, then it makes the process slower, and if it is greater than 1, then it makes the process faster. However, the relaxation parameter is in between 1 and 2. So what are the parameters which affects the value of relaxation parameter?
So the question is on the use of this relaxation parameter that we had implemented in the iterative solution process for the del square t equal to 0, the two dimensional steady state conduction that we solved. And the question is on what parameters this relaxation parameter depends. Actually, there is no hard and fast answer for that. This relaxation parameter is a quantity which is absolutely problem dependent, and from problem to problem, the optimum value, so to say, of the relaxation parameter will change. The specific problem that we have looked at, the two-dimensional steady state conduction problem, I think if you want to achieve the solution in the least number of iterations, there will be one value of omega, somewhere around 1.7, I think, and that can be obtained through a numerical analysis for this simple situation. But if you want to look at more complicated situations like the fluid flow problems, which Professor Sharma will discuss in the next couple of days, when you go to solve Navier-Stokes equations, if an iterative solution of the Navier-Stokes equation is involved, you will realize that it's really a situation where there is no hard and fast answer. In fact, most of the times, nonlinear equations like the Navier-Stokes equations require a under relaxation of the solution process, and usually you will be required to implement a relaxation parameter which will be much less than one in order for those nonlinear problems to be solved. So the answer is that there is no unique way to find out what is the correct or the good value of relaxation parameter. It is totally problem dependent, and most of the times, as the literature says, you have to actually find out the optimum value through what we call numerical experiments, which simply mean that you have to try out a few values and find out how it is going. One rule of thumb for sure is that nonlinear problems like the fluid flow situations will require necessarily an under relaxation. It will never work with an over relaxation. Simple problem like what we have done here can work with over relaxation also. Thank you. Yeah, so the question is on the convergence criterion for those iterations or iterative solution that we talked about in finite difference. So what is this epsilon? So epsilon is actually a user input. Epsilon is something typically that we are using as a convergence criterion number. Usually we are using this as 10 to the power minus 4 or 10 to the power minus 5, 10 to the power minus 6, etc. It depends on how accurate the solution requirement is, and the way it is implemented, at least one way it is shown here, is that what is done is you have the values for temperature available at the end of one iteration. What you do is you carry out the next iteration, and during this present iteration, let us say k to k plus 1, you find out at each node point what is the absolute difference between the value of temperature that was available at the end of previous iteration and what is the value of temperature that you are obtaining after the present iteration is over. You find this difference in the absolute sense at each grid point. There will be some grid point where this temperature difference will be maximum, and if you say that the maximum temperature difference at any grid point is less than say 10 to the power minus 5, we will claim that our solution is converged. It simply means that the temperature values are not really changing at all from one iteration to the next iteration, which essentially implies from a numerical point of view that you have achieved a converged solution. So that epsilon is a user input, and depending on what accuracy you want, you utilize that as 10 to the power minus 4 or minus 5. Thank you.
Last question from differential solution. Have you tried, sir, principle of resolution for inclined stress, shear stress?
Yes, of course I have. So the question is on the positive shear stress on that inclined surface, which we talked about when we described the sign convention. Yes, actually I have discussed that with a few solid mechanics people in my department as well, and unfortunately or fortunately, whichever way you want to look at it, they are not able to solve it for me. So the answer from one of the solid mechanics people is that it is really immaterial which way you call that as a positive direction. So it can be the way I have shown, or it can be in the opposite direction as I have shown. Finally, what happens is you work out the algebra and you take the limit as the element size tends to zero. The final conclusion, which is that the state of stress is represented uniquely in terms of the four stress components acting on two mutually perpendicular planes passing through the same point, remains the same whether you are actually looking at the shear stress in one direction or the other. So that's the answer that I got from the solid mechanics people, and that's what I am passing on to you right now. But we will still keep on looking at it from a more convincing point of view.
Sir, in this case, if we resolve shear stress into directions x and y, then we have to have the resolutions of a normal vector in y and x and y, because the direction of or sign convention of shear stress, it depends upon normal vector also.
That is correct. You need to resolve the normal vector for the surface also along with the shear stress. But if you look at the resolution carefully, it brings about some sort of an inconsistency in the way the positive shear stress is defined. So let me not take too much time on this. At the moment, what you can note is that it appears that it is immaterial whichever way you define the positive direction for the shear stress on that inclined plane, because the conclusion remains the same as far as the state of stress is concerned. Technically, there was one professor who had pointed out in the discussion last time from VIT Vellore. If you actually work out the entire algebra using the tensor notations, which are slightly higher level to follow, it automatically fits into the picture. So what I was trying to do was that I was trying to work this out in a Cartesian type situation in the two dimensional XY plane, and that's where the problems are coming. Nonetheless, we will keep discussing this on Moodle, I suppose, because that's the only option that we have right now. Thank you.
College of Engineering, Pune. Yeah.
So, sir, my question is that when we calculate the diffusive flux for the boundary node value, then in that book, the author has taken the value as k into 2 by 3 upon delta x into 9 times phi of A minus 8 times phi of E minus 8 times phi of P minus phi of E. So the author has said that he derived this from the expression used for the same expression used for deriving the quick scheme. So I was I tried to derive that equation, but the value, the expression wasn't, it wasn't, I wasn't able to derive the expression. So I was confused whether for quick scheme we always use that expression, or it is okay to use the normal difference between the two values for calculating the boundary node value at the boundary node, diffusion flux at the boundary node.
First of all, you are saying it is a diffusion flux, but let me first say that what the question is asking. There is a book on computational fluid dynamics by Verstek and Malisekara, and in that book, on chapter number 5, in problem number 5.4, he has shown what happens when you use this advection scheme near to the boundary is some special treatment is needed. So what he has done, he has created a mirror grid points near to the boundary, and he said that this was first done by Leonard. He has given a reference also, and for that mirror grid point, he is doing a linear extrapolation, and from that linear extrapolation, he has obtained an expression. I will open a slide and then discuss this. What happens is that if you use this advection scheme, if you are using inside for the grid point which are inside, let us say if you want to calculate use advection scheme and this face, you get one downstream neighbor, two upstream neighbor. But near to the boundary, I am showing you the enlarged view of what happens near to the boundary here. Near to the boundary, what happens is that if the mass flux is inward from the boundary, then this is your downstream neighbor, this is your upstream neighbor, and let us suppose this is your boundary grid point. So the distance between the upstream and downstream neighbor is, let us say, delta x. Now the distance between upstream and boundary grid point is delta x by 2, but the advections, but the quick scheme which we have derived, where we have 37.5% weightage to this downstream node, 75% weightage to this, and minus 12.5% weightage to this, that we have done when the distance between this two point is delta x, then this two point is also delta x. So near to the boundary, some special treatment is required. So for that, in problem number 5.4, what is given in the book of Malisekara, Verstek and Malisekara, is that using these two points, they have done what they are calling as a linear extrapolation. The distance between these two points is delta x by 2. So they take a mirror point which is away on this side at a distance delta x by 2. So the idea is you use phi is equals to ax plus b the way I had shown you. You put phi is equals to 0, x equals to 0, phi is equals to phi b. At x equals to delta x by 2, phi is equals to phi u. Then you get an expression for phi here. Now using the phi which you get from at this point and this point, you use the advection scheme which has been given. He has given this procedure. However, tomorrow I will discuss this separately, where the procedure I will propose is slightly different from what they have proposed. But I think you are struggling with the derivation which you have done. I would like to point out, just use an expression phi is equals to ax plus b and substitute x equals to 0, phi is equals to phi b. At x equals to delta x by 2, phi is equals to phi u here, and then you will get the mirror node phi value which is substituting in the usual expression for quick scheme. I hope I have answered your question.
This question is about partial differentiation. Suppose phi, that is stream function, is a function of x, y and t. It is quite possible that y is not equally dependent on x, y and t. The strength wise impact of x, y and t may be different phi stream function. My question is that how these weights of independent variables are taken care of while performing the partial differentiation.
So the question is on the stream function, where in general the stream function for a two-dimensional situation can be a function of x, y and time. And the specific question is, when we perform the partial differentiation, how do we take into account which variable amongst x, y and t affects the velocities more? I think that's the way at least I understood it. In fact, once you have a closed form relation, let us say for psi as a function of x, y and t, you don't have to bother about anything. Actually, all you need to do is perform the partial differentiation with respect to y to find the x velocity component, and the partial differentiation with respect to x with a minus sign to obtain the y velocity component. The function psi, which has all the dependence on x, y and time built into it, will automatically take care of which of the independent variables decides or determines or influences the velocities more. So this is from a purely mathematical point of view. In a real analysis of a real life system, complex fluid mechanics type problem, we don't ever have really a closed form solution available for a stream function. What we do is actually we solve the problem in the so-called primitive variables formulation, meaning that we don't really talk about the stream function at all when we solve the problem. We solve it using our Navier-Stokes equations, which are written in terms of the pressure and the velocity components. Having solved the equations, then you can actually find out numerically the stream function if you want at all. And that's the way to look at it. If some sort of a artificial problem like what we have been discussing in the fluid mechanics part is given, where there is a function specified for psi, then all the dependence of x, y, etc. is built into that function. So it's already there and you don't have to worry about it at all. All you need to do is differentiate it partially with y and x to find the velocity components. Thank you.
Sir, my question is regarding this flow along the stream line. Suppose that is curved surface is there. Energy equation for this one, this case, what will be that? Means what changes will be there? Energy equation for flow along stream line, and suppose that surface is curved surface, and for that the centripetal acceleration term may be there in energy equation.
So the question is, if we are talking about a fluid particle traveling along a curved surface, if we have to modify the energy equation, and actually the modification, if at all, will come in probably the momentum equation if there are any additional centrifugal type forces. But as far as the energy equation is concerned, I don't think there will be any change. You just have to implement it along the streamline, which is your curved surface. But perhaps if the centrifugal forces are large enough, then you may have to include that in the momentum equation.
Regarding that heat transfer taking place, generally what we are considering for heat conduction and heat advection, in that basically we are considering only flow, means that we are not considering any Reynolds number or Nusselt number or Weber number. Means will that laminar and turbulent flow consideration will be there?
The question is, we have talked about right now pure conduction and pure advection. So the question is, we have not considered the governing parameter like Reynolds number and Weber number. The answer to this question is, right now this parameter doesn't come into the equations or the physics which we have tried to formulate. In conduction, you cannot expect Reynolds number. In pure advection also, you do not have any diffusion term. So you cannot have Reynolds number. Reynolds number is the ratio of the inertia and the viscous forces. This terms will definitely come when we talk about the full Navier-Stokes equation. So just hold on for a couple of days. We'll have this terms in the when we talk about the Navier-Stokes equation. However, I would like to add that right now I am doing everything in a dimensional form so that you get feel of the terms, because many times if you use a non-dimensional form, your diffusion coefficient becomes 1 by Re, then you do not get feel of, here it is a thermal diffusivity. So right now I am doing it in a dimensional form, but the answer to your question is the Reynolds number terms are not relevant to the problems which we have discussed till now. Thank you.
One more question, sir, to Puranik, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, my question is something mathematical, more of mathematical. The exact solution 27, we have seen eigenvalue problem, and in finite difference solutions, we have seen boundary value problem. So I want to know how eigenvalue problems are different from boundary value problems, application-wise, maybe.
So the question is about, once we saw in the exact solution an eigenvalue problem, and in the finite difference solution, we saw what is a boundary value problem. In fact, let's just take that example. The del square t equal to 0, the 2D steady state conduction equation that we solved. So physically speaking, when you want to classify that as a problem, it is actually a boundary value problem. It is the absolute classification for that two-dimensional steady state conduction problem is that it is a boundary value problem. What that means is that it is related to a steady state process in certain domain. We are talking about a steady state conduction in a two-dimensional domain. And because it's a steady state problem, the temperature distribution within that domain is governed only by the boundary conditions. And that is what we mean by the boundary value problem. So boundary value problem is a physical classification, if you want, for a given problem. On the other hand, the first problem that we saw, which was a diffusion equation, it is actually what is called as an initial and boundary value problem. So mathematically, people will call it in that fashion. Physically speaking, you can interpret that as a problem where the variable value will be influenced not only by the boundary conditions, but also by the initial value of that variable at time equal to 0. So it turns out that when you want to solve these either the boundary value problems or the initial and boundary value problems, which I will still call as physical classifications, the mathematical techniques that we end up employing will generate these so-called eigenvalues of the problem, which essentially means that only at certain values of those what we call eigenvalues, the solution will be non-zero. And the general solution, if you recall from your differential equations, the general solution is essentially a summation of all possible solutions. So in case of the solution technique, mathematically speaking, each eigenvalue provides one solution to the problem. And since there are infinitely many eigenvalues in the situation, we actually end up adding all these individual solutions to form the most general possible solution for our problem. So I hope the distinction between an eigenvalue problem and the boundary value problem is clear. Eigenvalue problem will come in automatically if you want to solve either the boundary value problem or the initial and boundary value problem using any standard mathematical technique. So eigenvalue problem simply shows up as part of the solution procedure if you want to employ a mathematical technique. Hopefully I have answered to some extent at least. Yeah, Cummins College Pune, please go ahead if you have a question.
I have a question to Professor Purani on exact solutions 25. Yeah, as you said, this is initial and boundary value problem. The boundary conditions are u at 0 comma t equal to 0 and u h comma t equal to capital U, and the initial condition is u at y comma 0 is 0. So I have a question like at t equal to 0, I saw in all the problems in the lab that boundary condition is always winning over initial condition at t equal to 0. So is that so for every problem for exterior nodes?
So the question relates to the way we actually interpret initial conditions and boundary conditions. I think the way at least I have been interpreting this as at time equal to 0, when we set the initial condition, we look at all possible nodes or all possible locations. In this case, it is a one-dimensional domain. So all possible y locations, including even the boundary locations, can be considered to be part of the solution as far as time equal to 0 is concerned. And at time equal to 0, you set the initial condition, which is in this case equal to 0, to all y locations, including the boundary locations also. Whereas the boundary conditions are supposed to come into play and picture only when you initiate the problem. So in some sense, you can imagine at time equal to 0, you can think about time equal to 0 minus, which is one side of the 0, and time equal to 0 plus, which is the other side of 0, let's say. So that 0 plus is when the boundary conditions come into picture and then they start employing, whereas up to time equal to 0 minus, the initial conditions are prevailing. That's the way to interpret it, at least from my point of view. Hopefully that is giving some insight into it.
Yes, sir. But like the other question, similar question is to Professor Sharma, where we solved this problem, similar problem with FVM, finite volume method. It's topic number 2, slide number 51. He has shown at t equal to 0, the graph, where the boundary conditions are applied, like at x equal to 0, the temperature is 0, and x equal to 1, temperature is 100.
So the question is on the example problem which you had taken in the computational heat conduction, lecture number 2, slide number 51. So in that, I had taken a lot of problems where I had given the boundary condition. So the way I take it is that you had shown you, if you remember, let me go to the slide. The way I had discussed this topic is that the boundary condition is applied at all times for these blue circles, which are the grid points at the boundary, and the initial condition is applied at all the points which are inside this domain. Remember that I had shown you an animation where if you see the animation at time t is equals to 0, there is a step change from 0 to 30 degree centigrade. Then for this, all these nodes, it's constant at 30 degree centigrade. So if you remember, the first picture was something like this. So on the first node, it is 0, and the second node, it goes to 30. Let me use the pointer. On the first node, it is 0. On the second node, it is 30. Same 30 values continues for all the interior nodes, which are yellow circles. Then there is a sharp, there is a change, because there is a discrete representation from 30 to 100. So this is the way we apply the initial condition and boundary condition.
Yeah, so this is Bhalchandra Puranik. Actually, let me add to that. The it is again consistent with what I was talking about. So you can imagine that the CFD simulation initiates itself at the time 0 plus, so to say, when the boundary conditions are coming into picture and they get employed. So we will always talk about the time interval for the CFD simulation to be going from t equal to 0 plus to whatever maximum time that we are setting, so that when we start at 0 plus, we are essentially instantaneously employing the boundary conditions, and they will remain there for the remainder of the time. That's the way to interpret this, I would think.
I have another question about that the same slide. At t equal to 0, as you said, 0 plus, what type of distribution is going from x equal to 0 to 0.1? Like, what type of curve is that? On topic number 2, slide number 51.
So the question is that when we start the competition, how is the variation of temperature between x equals to 0 and x equals to 0.1? Just to tell you, if you take the length as 1, this is 0, this is 0.1, this is 0.3, 0.5, 0.7, 0.9 and 1. So here we are using a discrete solution. So we do not have any information that what is the temperature distribution between two nodes, to be honest. So we have a just discrete representation. However, when we plot, the plotting software, the way it works, it just, when we give two values, let us suppose if I give 0 here and if I give 30 here, when a plotting, you take it to a plotting software, it just joins by a line. So physically, if you want to ask that what is the temperature distribution between these two points, I would say that we do not have any idea, we are not calculating and our solutions are discrete, so we cannot say what is the temperature between these two.
Let me add one small point to that. In general, on a purely physical basis, you can expect some sort of a nonlinear distribution from the boundary point to the first point. But as has already been pointed out, we are looking at only discrete nodes as far as the solution is concerned. So many times some CFD analysts prefer plotting solutions only as discrete points. So they don't use any lines joining the discrete points. And this is to emphasize the fact that we are actually finding solution only at discrete points. So some people actually like to follow that procedure as well. So this is just for information. Thank you.
I have just last question. On topic number 2 and slide number 4 in grid generation, to Professor Sharma. So what happens to the corner nodes? It is not shown in this figure, but do we take average of the neighboring nodes, or there should be some corner nodes to maintain it 7x7?
It's one of the most question asked in this slide, that what happens to the corner. Okay, now in the way we have discretized, the corner node doesn't come into our expressions. If you remember, our computational stencil is such that value at a particular point is a function of its north, south, east, west neighbor. It is not a function of its corner neighbor. Okay, like the value here, the value at this node is not a function of this corner values. Okay, so when you go to the corner control volumes, it wants value from this north neighbor, this east neighbor, this south and this west. So the corner point doesn't come into the expression. I would like to add that I had used the boundary condition like 100 on the left wall, let us say 400 on the top wall. So you may again ask a question, what about corner? Corner is common to this two, whether it is 100 or 400. But I would say that it doesn't come into the calculation, so let us not bother about it. Thank you. MES Panvel, please ask your question.
I have a question for Professor Puranik. This is a general question, not related to any specific topic. Can you elaborate the difference between material rate of change and convective rate of change, and whether material rate of change is it same as the temporal rate of change?
So the question is on our kinematics discussion, where we had defined the material rate of change, convective rate of change and the temporal rate of change. specifically if material rate of change is equal to convective rate of change or if it is equal to temporal rate of change. Actually, the most general answer is that the material rate of change is equal to the temporal rate of change plus the convective rate of change. That's the relation. The way to interpret material rate of change is if you are following a given fluid particle along with it. So imagine that you are sitting on a fluid particle and moving along with the fluid particle with a sensor in your hand. The sensor will keep on noting the values of whichever quantity that you are trying to monitor. And as you look at the sensor, the change in the quantity shown by the sensor will give rise to what is called as a material rate of change. So by definition, it is the rate of change as observed by an observer who is moving along with the fluid. Now, when it comes to convective rate of change, it relates to the difference in the quantity, let's say temperature or density or whatever, between two points which are separated by certain distance in a space at a given time. So in general, at a given time instant, if you look at two different locations in the fluid domain, they will have in general different values for any quantity, say temperature or pressure. So this difference, which is with respect to the space, which is called the spatial rate of change, let's say, gives rise to this convective rate of change. And the third thing is the local rate of change, which is if you focus only on one given location in the space and simply monitor what is happening at that particular location for any quantity such as temperature or pressure or whatever. So the rate of change as observed by a sensor mounted at a given location fixed in space is what is called as the temporal rate of change or the local rate of change. So in general, the substantial rate or the material rate is equal to the temporal or the local rate plus the convective rate of change. If you actually go back to the relevant slides on kinematics, in the beginning itself, this was explained reasonably. And I think hopefully now this discussion can help you a little bit more. Nirma University, if you have a question, please go ahead.
Sir, my question is related to the differential analysis 25. Sir, in this slide, we have del by del t of rho u plus del by del x of rho u. So that term, and in generalizing this form, we have written in the box that del by del t of rho v plus del dot rho vv, which is a tensor form. So would you please re-explain the how to physically interpret these terms?
So the question is on differential analysis 25. Especially with respect to the conservative form of the expression on the left hand side. So we have written the Navier-Stokes equations here now. The leftmost part talks about the non-conservative approach, and the middle part, which we can replace the left hand side with, is the conservative approach. So if you look at any particular term here, this is actually written for the x direction, the equation that my highlighter is standing on. So each of these terms really added together. So partial derivative with respect to x of rho uu, partial derivative of rho uv with respect to y, and that of rho uw with respect to z, added together is to be expressed or interpreted as the net rate of x momentum leaving the elemental control volume on a per unit volume basis. So that is how we had brought out these expressions. So it's nothing different than, let me just go back. Yeah, right here. So you just, if you just look at the slides number 8 and 9, what we have done is we have found our balances, momentum balances, and if you look at in the boxed equation in the center of the slide, second term and third term, it is exactly the same as what we are talking about on slide number 25. So from there we interpret this three terms together, which are appearing in this x momentum equation, as the net rate of x momentum leaving our elemental control volume on a per unit volume basis. Thank you.
Sir, my another question is, the stream function is cannot be defined for the three dimensional, whereas we have for the streamline x, y and z component. So would you please point out the how to differentiate with this streamline and stream function?
That's a good question. I think the question is we have used the equation of streamline in three dimensions, but we pointed that the stream function is defined only for two dimensions. These are two different quantities physically, you can say. Streamline on its own we have defined as a line the tangent to which is pointing in the local velocity vector, and this is a general definition. It can be employed for a three-dimensional or a two-dimensional flow. On the other hand, by virtue of the definition of the stream function, it is restricted to two dimensions, because only in that two dimensions it satisfies the incompressible continuity equation identically if you utilize the stream function definition. So that's the only difference. It's restrictive from the definition itself to two dimensions, the stream function idea. To be honest with you, again, let me re-emphasize here that the idea of a stream function is somewhat old idea. If you look at the modern fluid dynamics, especially with respect to the CFD that we do nowadays, stream function is something of an outdated concept. It's not really that useful nowadays. It's just for historical purpose, I think, for two-dimensional flows, I think people will still want to look at it. But the definition is restrictive for stream function because it satisfies the continuity equation only in two dimensions, and that's the only difference between 3D and 2D. That's all.
And sir, differential analysis 19. I have asked one question. So what is a physical interpret? How to physically interpret that tau yj is equal to tau ji?
The question is on differential analysis 19, where we obtained this result tau ij equal to tau ji and how to interpret this. By the way, I didn't mention this in the lectures, but later on in one of the discussions I think I mentioned it. The manipulations that are getting done on slide number 19 are what are popularly called as the angular momentum equation for differential analysis. So what we are doing is that we look at the stresses acting on our given fluid particle, and we simply take the moments of this, and then we realize that there is only a net counterclockwise moment on the fluid particle given by the top expression. The top expression is just an equivalent expression to F equal to ma, the Newton's second law of motion. This is for moments. So we have the net moment equal to the moment of inertia times the angular acceleration experienced by the fluid particle. And then from calculus, we simply borrowed the expression for the moment of inertia for this rectangular fluid particle. And that's what my highlighter is showing right now. Having put together, we obtain a relation for the angular acceleration. And the argument is that in order for us to think about a very small infinitesimal fluid particle, we tend to shrink the size of the fluid particle to smaller and smaller sizes, thereby making that delta x and delta y very, very small. That doesn't mean that we are actually geometrically going to zero, but we simply realize that as delta x and delta y become smaller and smaller, it appears that for no specific reason, the angular acceleration of the fluid particle seems to shoot to infinity, because the numerator tends to a very, very small value. And physically speaking, such a situation is considered unacceptable, because this is a general discussion. There is absolutely no specific constraint that we are putting on the fluid particle. And in that sense, there is no reason for the particle to experience any extremely high value of angular acceleration. So in order to resolve this paradox, the only conclusion that seems to be occurring, if the mathematics also has to go in hand with the physics, is that there has to be a 0 over 0 limit which has at least a possibility of a finite limit in order for alpha z to be finite. And therefore, the conclusion that seems to come about is that the numerator, which is in terms of tau xy minus tau yx, must also be tending to a very, very small value in order for the expression to have a 0 over 0 limit. So that mathematically also it satisfies the limiting condition, and physically also we will realize that angular acceleration is not unnecessarily and for no reason shooting to infinity. In my understanding, that's the only the way to interpret this analysis. Usually you won't see this in a standard undergraduate fluid mechanics textbook. Usually you will see this in a slightly advanced fluid mechanics textbook, and normally this kind of an explanation is also not really provided. So it's up to us to interpret it whichever way we want. And what I have given you is at least my understanding of how to interpret this. Thank you.
I have a question in topic number 2, slide number 30. In this, the nodes are taken at the corners. So this method is applicable, this explicit and implicit are applicable to finite difference only, or because we are using it for finite volume also.
I agree with you. His question is, in this animations which I am showing you, actually I created this animation when I was teaching finite difference method, because here we have a two course, one is numerical method where we teach finite difference method. So I made lot of effort in creating this animation, and the same animation I am using in a finite volume method. So the position of the node is, you are right, it seems to be a finite difference method, but the animation which I am showing is indeed applicable in finite volume method. So it is just that it needs to be staggered slightly. So I agree with what you are saying. Thank you.
Yeah, I have one more question in topic number 2, slide number 4. In this, in the interior nodes, we have considered border CVs also. In interior CVs, we have considered border CVs also. So both are overlapping.
His question is that border control volume we are considered as interior control volumes. We are defining two type of control volumes, you can say, boundary control volume and interior control volume. And interior control volume constitute two types of control volume, border control volume as well as the control volume which is away from the border. Okay, so this is just a classification. I think it should be acceptable.
Discretization of the domain or discretization, we are generating a grid, and there are two types of the grid as far I know, that is a triangular grid and rectangular grid. So for a particular problem or particular geometry, which type of discretization is much more gives a result much more accurate? So how to decide how to discretize the domain?
The question is on grid generation, and the background is that there are triangular grids, there are rectangular grids. Triangular grids typically is an unstructured grid formulation. The rectangular grids are the Cartesian grid formulation. Now the question is, which one is more accurate? The unstructured grid formulation, if you take the same number of, let us say, Cartesian grid and do a Cartesian grid formulation for the same problem, the unstructured grid formulation, when you have unstructured grid, is slightly less accurate as compared to the Cartesian grid formulation, because the approximations which are used tends to make it more, it's less accurate. However, there are problems where you cannot have a Cartesian grid and you have no option other than to use the triangular grid or unstructured grid. So there, of course, unstructured grid is the only option, and it gives the good results, accurate results. Thank you. Yes, Sastra University, Tanjore.
Sir, I have 3 doubts. First one is for Puranik sir. It is in differential analysis 25. momentum conservation equation in differential vector form, the term del dot rho v rho into vector v into vector v is there. Can we write del dot rho into vector v is equal to vector v into, can we write the term vector v into del dot rho into vector v? If not, how can we multiply vector v with vector v?
So the question is on slide number 25, differential analysis. When I have written the momentum equation in the vector form, and specifically the question is related to this tensor product of two vectors which is appearing inside this divergence. So divergence of rho times v is what is written here. Let me actually not spend the time on this right now, because what we are interested right now is really the corresponding x, y and z momentum equations. So if you look at the x momentum equation which is available right at the top, all we do is we replace one v vector with the x component of the velocity, which is u, and thereby you obtain the top equation. It is much easier to interpret and write the equation in the Cartesian form. However, if you are interested to know this tensor product, it is actually what is called as a dyadic or a tensor product, which is a second order tensor, and it turns out to be having 9 components of the velocity. So if you want, let's say the first vector velocity has components u1, u2, u3, let's say, and the second velocity has components v1, v2, v3 in the three directions, then the tensor product v times vector v is going to have 9 components written in a matrix form. So the matrix form will read, the first row will read u1 v1, u1 v2, u1 v3. The second row reads u2 v1, u2 v2, u2 v3, and the third row will read u3 v1, u3 v2, u3 v3. So that's the way to interpret the tensor product of two vectors. That it will provide you a second order tensor, so that there will be 9 components corresponding to this tensor product of two vectors. But my suggestion at the moment right now is, I have written it just for the purpose of information, that rather than writing always the Cartesian components, we can write it in a compact form. There is no difference in the physical interpretation associated with either the Cartesian form or the vector form. So divergence of rho times v can be interpreted still as the net rate of momentum leaving a control volume. Now this is not in any particular direction, it is the vector momentum that we are talking about on a per unit volume basis. But my request right now is to actually concentrate more on the Cartesian components and make sure that the derivation of the Cartesian components is understood. With time, then you can easily get on to the vector forms and start manipulating those with the mathematical background that was provided in on day number one. So this is what I would like to request though at this point.
Thank you, sir. Another two doubts, sir. In transient heat conduction problems, we are taking convergence criteria as 10⁻⁶. How can we use this parameter to transient problems? I think it should be represented with some other parameter. This is one doubt. And second doubt is, topic 2, slide number 4, border CVs, border control volumes, and interior control volumes are shown. Border control volumes are subset of interior control volumes. Is there any significance of using separately this border control volume? So that is second doubt, sir.
So I'll answer the second question first. So the question is, what is the significance of using border control volume? There is a significance of using border control volume because if you remember, there was one question from College of Engineering Pune that when we use advection schemes, especially the higher order advection scheme for this border cell, if I want to remind you, when you use a quick scheme, there is a 37.5% weight to the downstream neighbor, 75% weight to the upstream neighbor, and minus 12.5% weight to upstream of upstream neighbor. So that weight we have obtained when the nodes are equispaced. Let us suppose if you want to calculate, use that direction scheme here, and these are two upstream neighbor, then you can see this circle and this circle are equispaced in the x direction. However, if you want to use here, then if you consider this three circle, the distance between this three circle is delta x by 2, the distance between these two circle is delta x. So many times when you are using, even in diffusion also, where the distance between these two node is delta x by 2. So for the border control volumes, when you want to implement, when you want to develop a code, you have to do some special treatment. So that was the reason that I had given it a separate name, so that we, when we want to discuss the implementation details, we can, we have to be very specific on which control volume we are talking of. Thank you. And regarding your first question, the question is that we are using a convergence criteria and we said it 10 to power minus 3. The question is some other value should be used or some other parameter should be used. Let me tell you convergence criteria which we are defining, epsilon, in this is based on whether if you are following unsteady state formulation, then the, we want to check for steady state. Steady state, when we want to check, we have to that's as used as a stopping criteria, and computer doesn't understand what zero is. So user has to define what he means by zero. You can define as 10 to power minus 3, another person can define it as a 10 to power minus 4, but it is up to you, because the user has to make a decision that what he wants to call as a practically zero, and at the same time he has to check whether if he has used 10 to power minus 3 as practically zero for a particular problem, and if he uses 10 to power minus 4, if the change in the result is negligible, then he can come to a conclusion. I hope I had answered your question.
Actually, my question is, for transient problem, we are using convergence criteria. Means, convergence means it is the value nearer to the value what we got by analytical analysis. For example, if a 2D conduction problem is there, steady state, so there we use the convergence criteria as old value minus new value by new value should be less than some value. Like that we will put, but actually in transient problems, we will get a particular value at particular node at different time intervals, time steps. So this convergence criteria in code, what we are using is the value new, what we got at next time step minus previous time step, like that we are using. So this is the difference between the value of previous time, difference between present time step to the previous time step. So for this, can we use this name convergence criteria? I think it should be named with some other parameter notation.
I agree with you. I think you have a right point. I should not call it as a convergence criteria. Probably convergence criteria word is good if there is a steady state formulation. I think the better word will be the steady state criteria, steadiness criteria. So I agree with you, you are right. It should not be a convergence criteria. It should be steadiness criteria or steady state criteria. Thank you for your suggestion. VIT Pune.
My question is related to lab session 2.
Yes.
That is one-dimensional conduction with heat generation. We have solved this problem with positive heat generation. So while executing the code in the lab, I have given negative value of heat generation, right? The temperature distribution was upward dome with positive, and with negative heat generation, the dome was downward. My concern is that when I have given a sufficiently large volumetric heat generation, that I have gone below absolute zero, which is a violation of basic law of thermodynamics.
Question is that for the one-dimensional lab session, we had a problem one-dimensional conduction with volumetric heat generation. So you had used a positive value, you got a maxima, and when you use a negative value, you have got a minima, that's what you are saying. So the dip in the curve, and then you are saying that for very large value, you got that, you found the temperature distribution is going less than 0. Now, my question is, I would like to ask that when you say very large value, you have used a very large negative value or very large positive value when you got less than 0? If you use a very large negative value, then it is expected that it should, although negative value of volumetric generation is unphysical, but if you use that, it should go, it will be unbounded, as I said. I had mentioned that if you use a volumetric heat generation, your solution will become unbounded. Unbounded means it will be outside the bounds of the boundary values. So, here the boundary condition are 0 and 100 degree centigrade. So, for large positive value, it will go more than 100, and for large negative value, it can give and go less than 0 degree centigrade. Although the problem is unphysical, but if it is there, the result is correct.
For the lab session,
yeah.
After giving boundary conditions, we are getting a temperature counter plot. So, how to read that counter plot exactly, that we are not getting? If possible, explain with one case.
Okay.
And so, how to interpret it or how to write that results?
The question is how to interpret the isotherm contours, isotherm lines. I will take the isotherm contours and discuss how to interpret. Let me take, yeah, this is a good picture. So, let us suppose you got a steady state temperature contour which problem is this? This problem corresponds to left wall 100 degree centigrade, bottom wall 200 degree centigrade, right wall 300 degree centigrade and top wall 400 degree centigrade. So, we got a temperature contour like this. Now, the message you can take qualitatively by looking into this picture is you can see that near to this left wall is at 100, this is 150. This is a problem with no volumetric heat generation. So, the temperature distribution will be monotonic. So, all the lines in between 100 and 150, sorry, let me use a pointer, all the line, this is 150, this is 100. So, this is 110, this is 120, this is 130, 140 and 150. So, all the lines are having temperatures which are greater than 100. So, at least you can understand if the temperature near inside this plate near to the boundary is greater than 100, then the heat transfer will be outward. This is the way you can interpret. When you go to the bottom wall, it is more interesting. What you see is that there are two parts of the bottom wall. Left part where the temperature above is less than 200, like here it is 190, 180, 170, 160 and 150. And on the right half, you find that temperature is 210, 220, 230. So, what you are seeing is on the left part of the bottom wall, heat is going in because the temperature above is less. On the right part, heat is coming out. Similar is the case when you go to this wall. If you go to isotherms for the on a second problem, which I had considered where left wall is 100, bottom wall insulated, right wall constant heat flux and top wall convective boundary condition. In this case, you can have a different interpretation. In this case, this is a good case where you can check whether the plot which you have got is correct, because bottom wall you are having an insulated boundary condition. So, when you want to interpret this result, you first need to check whether the line intersecting the bottom wall is vertical or at wall. You can see dT by dy here is 0, here also it is 0. So, you can check that this is, you have implemented insulated boundary condition and the steady state temperature distribution is indeed giving dT by dy is equals to 0 at bottom wall. On the right wall, it is a constant heat flux boundary condition. So, dT by dx is minus Qw by k. So, dT by dx here should be, so the slope here should be constant, which is indeed being followed at this wall. So, that way this is a good test as far as this picture is concerned. And as far as heat transfer is concerned, you can draw similar conclusion here that there on the left wall, there is a top part where the temperature nearby is less than 100. So, the heat transfer is inward and bottom side it is outward. So, this is the way you can interpret. When you look into the plot of, let us say, variation of local heat fluxes on this wall. So, with respect to how heat flux is varying, if you plot that, you indeed get a result where there is change in the sign of the heat flux. So, in the engineering parameter, this is reflected, but the reason why that change is happening, you can confirm through this isotherm contour. If you go to the fluid flow problem, if you, let us say, if you are a car designer, you design different shapes of the car, you create a movie of the flow structures, and you calculate the engineering parameter, and let us suppose a particular design gives you the least drag force, but the reason why that is giving a least drag force will come if you try to make a story out of the movie which you have created for that best design as far as the flow structure is concerned. So these flow structures are very important in scientific understanding of why something is happening. Thank you. We will take the last question from JNTU Hyderabad.
Hello sir, this is regarding topic 2, slide number 66. It is about two-dimensional heat conduction problem where the boundary conditions have been shown. Particularly for the right boundary where the constant heat flux is applied, instead of going with the boundary nodes shown by blue circles, can we just balance the heat fluxes for the boundary control volumes on the right boundary?
Okay, yeah, the question is interesting. When we are doing an energy balance for the boundary control volume, let us say border control volume, in this case let us say this control volume, the question is, rather than using this boundary condition, insulated boundary condition, can we take this is the east face, this is the west face, the heat flux on the east face and the west face are 0. So basically if you do this way, what you are saying is that del by del x of qx is equal to 0, which makes del square t by del x square is equal to 0, and it indeed follows this insulated boundary condition. So yes, you are right, you can do that way also. Thank you. We will stop here, and we will have the question answer share tomorrow at the same time, 4 to 5:30.